you're in Kids Club, you go and have a great time. Those of you who are in here with me, please take your Bibles, turn to Revelation chapter 3. I have an outline to my message that's in your bulletins today. If you happen to pick up a bulletin, and we're going to look at realizing the steps to the righteousness that we find in Jesus Christ. Now, I knew this long before I moved here to be with you, but if there's one thing I know about the state of Indiana, you know your basketball, right? Now, how many basketball fans do we have here today? Do we have basketball fans? We've got a few. Sure we do. How many of you follow the Hoosiers? Okay, several, most of you. Well, what about the Boilermakers, Robert? I knew. Oh, got some over here too, yes. The Butler Bulldogs. Now, my wife, that's one of her teams. Now, if you're a Notre Dame fan, just let me say you're outnumbered, all right? Now, I know it's not basketball season today, but later on in this message, I just happen to be sharing some basketball stories and some analogies that will point us to some Bible truths. And I hope that that's okay. But the Bible, but the basketball stories come a little bit later. I've got a different type of a story now. How many of you have grandkids? You know I've got to tell grandkids stories anytime I can. But is there one question that you wish your grandkids would never ask you, especially in front of their brothers or sisters? You know what that question is. Papa, am I your favorite? You've heard it, right? You've been there. You have heard it. But you know what? That question is actually pretty easy to answer, especially if the other siblings are there. What's the answer? I love you all the same. I love you all the same. Now, this week I was eating lunch with my two grandsons, my son's two boys, and my 11-year-old asked a different sort of question. He said, Papa, am I your best friend? Now, I don't know if you put that together or not, but that question is a little bit more difficult to answer, especially with his brother sitting right there. Whenever Paxton asked me that question, he included the whole world. He said, am I your best friend? The answer, I love you all the same, just wasn't going to cut it. So what do you say when your 11-year-old grandson looks you in the eye and says, am I your best friend? So I just looked at him right back and I said, well, not exactly. Now, his answer before I could give him the answer, his response was this. Is your best friend that hairy guy? And I said, what hairy guy? And he said, you know, that hairy guy that you and Nana talk about. Now, at this point, I was grateful for Kathy's interruption. She said, Paxton, Harry was my daddy. So, Harry was my father-in-law, but he passed away years and years and years before Paxton was ever born. So Paxton never got a chance to meet him. Now, why have I told you all of those stories? Today I'm going to talk to you about the Sardis church in Revelation chapter 3. And Paxton reminded me of a story that I had with that hairy guy. My father-in-law. Every time I read this passage of scripture, I think about my father-in-law. Now, Harry was not a preacher, but he was a fantastic Bible teacher. Have you ever known those guys that knew more scriptures than the pastor? Well, Harry was one of those guys. There was a small church in Arkansas, and they were about to close their church because they had gone well over a year in their effort to find a pastor. Finally, they asked Harry to teach for them until they could find a pastor. So for 1.5 years, even though he wasn't a preacher, for 1.5 years, even though he didn't consider himself a pastor, he was the interim pastor. He taught them every Sunday. During that time, he encouraged them to make a lot of repairs on their church facility. They really responded to his leadership. They were willing to do almost anything he asked them to do, except for one thing. He asked them to consider changing their name. What was their name? The Sardis Baptist Church. Now, why did Harry want them to change their name? Well, let's see. In Revelation chapter 3, we read these words. To the angel of the church in Sardis write. Now, I want to remind you, the word angel there means pastor. Okay? To the angel of the church in Sardis write. These are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you're dead. Wake up! Strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and what you have heard. Hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me dressed in white, for they are worthy. The one who is victorious will like them be dressed in white. I will never blot out the name of that person from the book of life, but will acknowledge that name before my Father and his angels. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Now, today I have 5 simple points that I want to share with you regarding this letter to the church at Sardis. So if you leave your Bibles open and follow with me, I think that you will be able to see each of these points whenever we come to them in Scripture. Now, if you've got your bulletins with you and you're filling in the blanks, here's blank number 1. We need to learn how to recognize our reputation. We need to learn how to be able to determine who we are, what other people think about us, and what God thinks about us. Look at verse number 1. It says, these words are coming from the one who holds the 7 spirits of God. Now, I shared with you in previous sermons, anytime you read the number 7 in the book of Revelation, it means complete. So, these words are coming from the God who has the complete Spirit of God. And the 7 stars. The stars represent the churches. So he holds the complete church. So this is this simply means that even though these letters were sent to 7 individual churches, it's a reference to the complete churches, including us here today. The Bible says he knows our deeds. He knows our works. He knows what you've been up to. The Bible even says that he knows the thoughts and the intents of everything. He knows what you're thinking. He knows the intent of your mind. Whenever my father-in-law tried to get the Sardis Baptist Church to change their name, it had to do with the reputation of the Sardis church that was mentioned in the Bible. What was their reputation? To the world, they had a reputation of being alive. But in the eyes of God, they were what? They were dead. There wasn't any life to them. Now, everybody has a reputation. And that reputation is either good or bad. Now, as I was thinking yesterday about this message, there was a phrase that popped into my head. I don't know if it came from the Lord or came from something I heard years and years ago, but it's something worth remembering. Reputations are not built on middle ground. Right? If you have a good reputation at work, it's because you've taken the higher ground at work. If you have a reputation of being lazy at work, it's because you've taken the lower ground at work. Reputations are not built on middle ground. And the same is true for a church. If our church has a good reputation, it means that we have taken the higher ground on our beliefs. It means that we have taken the higher ground on our actions. It means that we've taken the higher ground on our love and our compassion to God and to other people. So if we have a reputation, it means that we have taken the higher ground. But the church at Sardis, even though to some they appeared to be active, they were dead or ready to die. Let me give you a little bit of history about this town called Sardis. You know, this is not found in our Bible, but it is found in history books of that day. The name Sardis, it's actually a plural noun. And so it really means two cities in one. And in fact, there were two towns. One was high up on a mountain, and the other was down by the river in the valley. But they all functioned at the same town. Whenever an enemy would come to attack, everybody would run up to the mountain, and an attack seemed to be nearly impossible. At that time, the city had a king by the name of Croesus. And it was Croesus who brought the city to the peak of its success, but it was also this same man that brought the city to its disaster. There was a Greek wise man, a philosopher by the name of Solon. He warned Croesus that he was filled with pride. He warned Croesus that he wasn't even watchful over his city that he governed. But the king didn't listen to the wise man. And soon the king of Persia came and took the city. Now, the reason this city had fallen was simply because they were too lazy to watch. Here's my point. Now, all of this would have happened about 500 years before Jesus, but there's an interesting testimony about this particular city. They weren't willing to watch and protect what they had. And so they lost it all. If we don't keep an eye on preserving what we have here in our church, if we don't keep an eye on building healthy families and healthy homes, before long, within a generation, we will lose everything simply because we were too lazy to watch. Which takes us to point number two. Not only do we recognize our reputation, but number two, we reinforce what remains. Look at verse 2. Jesus says, wake up, strengthen what remains, strengthen what is about to die, because I have found your deeds unfinished before the sight of the Lord. So God is looking at what this church is doing, and they're not seeing anything through. They're not completing the task that God had given them to do. Have you ever found yourself getting busy in the ministry, but then you lay it aside and you don't complete the task that had been given to you or that you agreed to do? So we find here in the scripture that we are challenged to reinforce everything that remains. Now, how do you do that? Well, let me just share a story with you. My daughter was simply not the athlete of our family. However, she is the only one from our family that has been on ESPN's Sports Center. That's a whole other story. Whenever she played soccer, and one night she did play and got knocked down, it was me. I had to go and carry her off the field. Now, she was hurt, but she wasn't hurt seriously. She was embarrassed, and she just wanted her daddy. Well, she was about 7 then. When she was in the 6th grade, she played basketball that year, and near the end of the season, she had a few remarkable moments. Now, let me say this, first of all, she had not scored a point all year up to this point. Not one point. She was a decent rebounder. She was a good free throw shooter. She was a great defender. But whenever she dribbled the basketball while running, she looked like somebody who was trying to chase a tire down the street. But she was a great player to have on your team. You just needed somebody else to bring the ball down the court. I remember the very first basket she ever made. The ball was about to go out of bounds in the far left-hand corner of the court. She ran over, and whenever she retrieved it and she grabbed it, she was double-teamed in the corner. She couldn't find a place. She was about to fall out of bounds. She couldn't find a place or a teammate to throw the ball to. And the referee was about to call 5 seconds and award the ball to the other team. She knew that, and she thought in a panic. She thought, if I can just find the goal, I'm going to throw the ball toward the goal and somebody from my team might get it. So she threw the ball at the goal. It went almost to the ceiling and came down nothing but net. To hear her describe it after the game, it was intended to be nothing more than a pass. But I want you to notice what I said she did. She thought, where is the goal? Aim for the goal. I'm being double-teamed by life. Aim toward the goal. Somebody is there to help me. Whenever you're cornered by your situations in life, you need to remember that Jesus is always close by. And ultimately, He is always your goal. If you're a Christian, reinforce that spirit that remains in you with the truth of God's Word. Now, I think that the secret to Jennifer's success in basketball that year was how well she listened. Now, whenever I was in school, I was a good free throw shooter, so I made sure she was. And how did she reinforce her free throw shooting? By practicing. And she shot and she shot and she shot until she was pretty good at the free throws. Matter of fact, in the championship game, with a couple of seconds to go, she made 2 free throws to tie the game and send it into overtime. And then her team won in overtime. So you've got to reinforce. You've got to reinforce all the things that you've been told. You've got to reinforce what remains in your life. And then we move on to number three. You remember what you have received. Look at the first part of verse 3. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard, and hold on to it fast. Now, it goes on to say, and repent. But I want us to say, let's hold on to that fast. We want to focus on that part. So, let's look back at what we've covered so far. Over the years, this church at Sardis had developed this reputation of just going through the motions. They went through the motions without relying on the power of God. They looked alive on the outside because they were moving. They looked alive on the outside because they were going through the motions. But they were dead on the inside. Have you ever gone through a time in your life that you just feel so empty inside, you just feel dead on the inside? Reinforce what remains. And let your mind go back and remember how God has blessed you in the past. And remember that He wants to bless you again. The only way to strengthen the good godly things that remained was to remember what we had received from God in the past. Now, you cannot function well as a Christian without a testimony. So let me ask you, what is your testimony? Have you ever formed that testimony in your mind in case you ever got a chance to share it? What is your testimony? What has God saved you from? Has He saved you from your sins? How has God redirected your life? In what areas do you need God to redirect your life now that would bring you happiness again? You see, our testimony is an acknowledgement of what we have received from God. And the scripture in this passage is teaching us that whenever we feel a disconnection in our lives from God, we hold fast to what we've previously received. We remember the blessings of God, and then we repent. Now, again, repent doesn't simply or always mean, "I'm sorry, Lord." The true key word of repentance, it means we turn. So whenever you repent, you admit to God that this isn't easy. Whenever you repent, you admit to God that you're going through a struggle and that you can't do it alone. Whenever you repent, you admit to God that you have been the ones that have distanced yourself from Him. He hasn't distanced Himself from you. And whenever you repent, you are committing yourself to turning back to the right direction and getting back on course with God's plan. That's whenever your repentance is sincere. That is sincerity, and that takes us to the fourth point. We repent in sincere reverence. You know what reverence is. It's an act of worship that shows respect to God. It's an act of worship that shows respect to God. Let me just read to you what Jesus says about the insincere in this passage. He says in verse 4, He says, "If you do not wake up, I will come to you like a thief." So in other words, if you don't wake up, you're going to be surprised one day whenever you find yourself not in my good graces. If you do not wake up, you will feel unprepared when I come from you. When I come for you. That reminds me of the story of the 10 virgins. 5 of them were wise, 10 were foolish. They were all waiting to meet the bridegroom. They were waiting for their wedding day. 5 of them were prepared, and they had extra oil for their lamps. And they went and met the bridegroom, but 5 were not prepared. They did not have extra oil for their lamps, and whenever their lamps went out, they couldn't find the bridegroom. In verse 4, Jesus said that the sincere do not soil their garments. The sincere try to live clean lives, And Jesus simply says they will walk with him because they're worthy. It's just as simple as that. They will walk with Jesus because they are worthy. Let's look down at verse 6 and focus on verse 6 now. I want us to look at this last point that I want to make with you, number 5, that we rebound toward righteousness. We rebound in the direction of God's righteousness. So look at verse 6. Whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So, I want you to say that verse now. Repeat after me. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. One more time. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Okay, question. Are you a good listener? All right, I'm going to tell you that if you were to ask Kathy if I was a good listener, she would say, for the most part. For the most part, I am a good listener. But there are some areas that I'm not the best. And she would tell you that too. But by the same token, we have developed some things since we've lived here, since she has retired and quit working. We live in a small enough house. I'm harder of hearing than I used to be. And we live in a small enough house, Kathy will start a conversation with me from anywhere in the house. Now, she usually starts the conversation where I am. And she will walk away into the other room, still carrying on the conversation, go into the closet, and once she walks into the closet, her voice is 100% gone, and she will come back in the middle of the next sentence. Now, if she's just talking, making conversation, I wait till she gets back and I say, "What did you just say? I lost you for a minute." But if it's important, I get up out of my chair, follow her into that next room if I want to hear her. Here's my point. Sometimes the voice of God is clear and distinct. And sometimes we don't hear as well as we once did. And sometimes when we're hearing the voice and the call of God, sometimes we've got to get out of our chair to continue our conversation with God. Are you a good listener? Listening to God is important. Listening to the heartfelt feelings of your spouse is important. Listening to the needs of your children is important. I just want to say this in passing. I love the kids that we have coming to our church here right now. And I love listening to their stories. And I want them to know that. I hope that they know I enjoy every word that any of them have to share with me. Got a couple more stories and then I'm going to quit. I had quite a bit of time to spend with my 11-year-old grandson at the beginning of this week. I got to watch him play basketball in a summer league two nights. Now, he is the biggest player on his team by far. But the first night, their opponents, well, they played the Goliath Giants. I mean, that's just it. They were enormous. And all game long, they pushed Paxton underneath the basket and kept him from getting rebounds. He had a game the next night. And so, the next day, we were talking. And Paxton, I've got two of my grandkids that ask me for stories all the time, and Paxton's one of them. He asked me to tell him a story. I thought, I can talk about last night's game, and I'll get there in a minute. So I said, you know, you remember last night when you were playing against those big players? He said, yeah. I said, I remember that whenever I played ball, I played on the inside too, and I was usually smaller than my opponent. And I told him what I would do to box out and hold my position. I told him that I would push back against my opponent because whenever somebody shot the ball and it was time to rebound, the basketball was my prize. And I told him that I wanted to keep my opponent from getting my prize. So I would box them out and back them up to where they couldn't get to my prize. I had Paxton sitting on the edge of his seat. I was so impressed with my story. And then Paxton said, Pop, do you have any advice for my game tonight? I said, Paxton, that was the advice for your game tonight. You know, sometimes God in His Word or through His Spirit keeps giving us advice and somehow we miss it. We keep missing it. But that doesn't have to be the case for you today. If you have ears to hear, listen to what the Holy Spirit is saying to our church today. One final story. The best basketball game my daughter ever played in. She didn't even score a point. I wouldn't have even thought of the story had it not happened on the day that Kathy's father, Harry, passed away. We received a call that morning that Harry had had a heart attack. His heart had failed him and he passed away at age 63. And I remember that we weren't going to go on to Arkansas to be with the family until the next morning. And it was a couple of hours away from her ball game. And Jennifer asked, Daddy, can I still play tonight? You know, Grampy never got to come watch me play. And, you know, maybe he can see me tonight. So, of course, Kathy stayed home. Joshua stayed home. But Jennifer and I went to her ball game. And it was a tournament game, and they had played this team earlier in the year. Jennifer was in the sixth grade. She may have been 5'6", which was pretty tall for that league. But the other team, it was sixth, seventh, and eighth grade. The other team had an eighth grader that was 6 foot tall and over. And I knew my daughter would get to guard that girl some. So as we're riding, I said, Jen, I said, remember, this team beat you by over 20 points last time you played them. And I said, you're going to have to guard that girl some. And whenever you do, just remember this. If she doesn't touch the ball, she can't score. And see, their whole thought was to throw it into the tall girl, and she would turn and put it in the basket. But I told Jennifer, I said, if she doesn't touch the ball, she can't score. Every player had to sit out for a quarter, and Jennifer was picked to sit out for the first quarter. The team was up by 10, the other team. They were beating them so bad. And they put Jennifer in the game. And instead of playing behind her, Jennifer played in front of her. She thought, I can't let her ever catch the ball. And the 6 foot tall girl never scored another point. and they won the game. So my point in closing for you today is this. If we get more serious about the prize that we possess, and we don't let Satan touch the ball, he can't score against us. He can't knock us back. Our problem is in our daily walk with Jesus Christ. Just like the church of Sardis, we're not paying close enough attention. Let's begin paying attention today. Can we pray? Father God, I thank you for this day. I thank you for your blessings. And Father, I pray that you would take this message for what it was intended to be. I pray that you would use it and bless it. Lord, I don't know why that it seemed necessary to me to tell so many stories today, but I'm hoping and I'm praying that these stories have gotten through to somebody to where they understand your truth a little bit better. Meet our needs today. And if there's somebody here that is not a Christian, but they want to become a Christian today, Father, I pray that during this closing song, they would have the comfort of coming down to me during this service and just letting me know that they want to become a Christian. Bless us in the name of Jesus our Lord, I pray. Amen. Would you stand with us while we sing this song? If you have a need for Christ in your heart today, won't you come?
Bless you.